have a quorum today, so I'll welcome everybody to the September 19th, 2017 meeting of the Northampton Transportation Parking Commission. My name is Ryan O'Donnell, I'm the chair of the commission. And let's go around the room and introduce ourselves to the benefit of the public starting with our director of planning, Stan.
Hi, director of planning, Stan Bell.
Gary Hartwell, citizen.
Rich Cooper, citizen.
Dave Pomeranz, director of central services.
Krista Grinnett, citizen.
Gina Lee Shara, city councilor.
Jody Casper, police department.
Beth Kaplowitz, DPW.
Nancy Forrestall, assistant city collector.
Patty Chan, DPW.
Donald Scalia, director of the DPW.
And I'll note that Councilor Dennis Bidwell is also in the audience for Ward 2 as well. And we'll start public comment now. This is an opportunity for members of the public to speak on any issue you wish. We ask you to keep it to about 3 minutes, if you will. And because generally these items have not been posted on our agenda, we don't really engage in a back and forth during public comment. It's your opportunity to express your views to us, but you should know that I, as the chair or others, can follow up with you individually after the meeting. If you want to talk on one of the items that is on the agenda, feel free to wait for that time and we'd be happy to recognize you or do both things. So with that, is there anyone who'd like to give public comment to start with? Please. If you give your name and address.
Sure. My name's Beth Stepmold. I live at 231 Audubon Road in Leeds. And I just told a friend I feel a little guilty given the state of the world coming to talk about parking, but I'm here to talk about a couple of downtown parking issues with the hope that maybe they can be addressed. I don't think it's enough to rely on the fact that the reparking prohibition is nothing new downtown. As the parking office told me, it's nothing new. It's always been that way. Knowing that you're not supposed to refeed a meter is one thing. Knowing that you can't move your car to another place on Main Street because you have additional business near the second place is another. But when you think about it, you realize that the kiosks can't distinguish between those two scenarios, and since there's a limit, they probably shouldn't. But folks parking downtown need to understand and know so they can plan. So here's what happens now to someone unaware of this prohibition. They move down Main Street to find another place, and if they've already parked 3 hours in the first spot, the kiosk won't allow them to pay. Can't find more parking. So they've already driven around burning fossil fuels, maybe for some time. That this happened to a friend of mine's out of town visitor, who then drove around some more looking for a meter. So my hope is that the downtown signs could address the reparking issue, and I have a handout here. As the 2015 Walker Parking Report recommends, I'm giving you page 33. I don't think I have enough for everybody, but maybe you can share. Page 33 of that report recommends signage that specifically addresses reparking. I know this must seem silly to you all, and I apologize, but it does specifically say that the signage is difficult to understand and that it needs to say that reparking is not permitted. It would also be nice to know if the 3 hour Armory and Masonic Street lots are connected on the system. In other words, can you move your car from Masonic to Armory if you have more business at that other area after 3 hours, or is it 3 hours for both of them? And it's also nice to know when the prohibition resets. I've learned it's after 2 hours, but you have to call and ask that. Finally, I hope you'll look into reasons why the new pay-by-plate system can fail. It did for me. I returned within the time I had paid for to find my car ticketed. Luckily, I don't know why, I had stuffed that receipt in my pocket and the enforcement officer was still in the lot. She couldn't have been nicer. She took my ticket and my receipt and got the ticket voided. I'm left to wonder if this is a Wi-Fi failure, if we're to expect this. I'd really rather put my receipt on the dashboard. And if I do that now, will the reinforcement officer look at it? I noticed in the Gazette recently that the paper's already asking merchants to advertise in their shop local holiday promotions. We want folks to shop locally. I like shopping locally, but I think our merchants count on dollars from out-of-town shoppers as well. The kiosks are challenging enough. Several weeks ago, my visiting cousin, whom I told about long-term parking options, tried on a kiosk, gave up, and looked for a meter. Our downtown parking system should be as user-friendly as possible. We all know that one can shop from the comfort of one's easy chair. So, thank you.
Thank you. Do we have extra copies of the agenda, by any chance?
I have extra copies of everything.
Okay. Can we pass them up to the front? They have my contact info on it. Someone, if you want to follow up directly after. Anyway, it's there if you need it. Is there anyone else who would like to provide? Yes, sir.
My name is Tom Worcester, and I live on Stonewall Drive here in Northampton. And I'm here to request no parking signs on the street. People pass these around. Give you an idea of what I'm here about. I talked with Mr. O'Donnell about this, and you sent me back an email that you felt two parking or two car lengths would be sufficient space, and I'll take anything I can get, but I'd much prefer it was four or even more. I went down and talked with the fire department, and if you look at the pictures that I'm sending around, trying to make the corner with a fire truck with people parked down at the bottom, even two car lengths up, is going to be difficult, to say the least. Getting off of 5 and 10 onto Stonewall Drive with people doing 50 and 60 miles an hour is a harrowing experience that I've experienced for over 30 years. You know, it never used to be a problem, and now it is. So if I could have no parking signs put on the street, it's going to help me and my neighbors, who are, some of them already been rear-ended trying to get back into Stonewall Drive. It would be very, very helpful.
Okay. Well, thank you, and we'll continue to talk about this, and we can put it on a future agenda of this commission meeting for a full debate.
Oh, that was my other question. Mm-hmm. How long does it take for you to arrive at a decision?
Depends what it is. We like to make things as difficult as possible. It depends what it is. Yeah. But if it's an ordinance change, that has to go to the city council. And that takes two readings, generally over a period of a month, in addition to the debate in this commission. If that gives you a sense of the time frame.
Just like they say on Game of Thrones, winter's coming. And this street is only like 22 feet wide. And it gets even narrower once they start plowing the snow. And people parking down there is just going to be impossible. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Hopefully our politics are less complicated than on Game of Thrones. So let's see. Anyone else like to give public comment this time? No? Okay. I should have announced this. I just forgot. We are audio and video recording this. So let's see. The first item is approval of the minutes for June 20th. 2017. Is a motion to approve these minutes?
So
made by Mr. Palmer and seconded by Mr. Hartwell. Any discussion or changes? All in favor of approving the minutes, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Those are passed unanimously. Reports from departments? Planning to start?
We were talking about some more detail later for potential ordinance, but we just notified the, we decided who we're wearing our bike share to. We can have a bike here. We can talk about it for, in terms of rules later. But we're doing electric assist bike. In large part, we've looked at sort of different demographics of who uses bikes. Pedal assist bikes should get a whole new demographic. We know that sort of it's mostly, you know, middle class 20, 30 year olds who use bicycles. And we're really trying to get sort of across the board. So, committee had four different proposals from people, and we chose, in the end, we decided that all this was the best.
Thanks. Any questions for Director Fudd? Shift to the department of public works. for updates?
Sure. Our paving contract for 2017 is complete. Palmer Paving completed work on Ryan Road and Park Hill Road. We repaved sections of those. Total value of that contract, by the way, was in excess of $500,000. Crack sealing contract, that's also been completed. Crack sealing on various streets throughout the city. As far as traffic calming items, we're continuing to work through the backlog of traffic calming requests that we have. A report for Main Street Leeds is currently being drafted. We have requests for traffic counters on both North Farms Road and Gothic Street. So this fall, the plan is to get those counts on Gothic Street. North Farms Road is under construction for a water line replacement. So because of that construction and the traffic disruption that's caused by that, we can't really get an accurate count while that project is happening. So we will likely defer that to the spring, pending sort of completion of this project. You know, if it gets done sooner than we had anticipated, we'll see what we can do before the snow falls. So we have a variety of utility reconstruction, roadway reconstruction projects ongoing right now. Day Avenue, we're doing some utility work there. That includes a new sewer line. We may need to delay paving until the spring on that roadway because of some unforeseen circumstances involving the sewer. But I'll have an update for the commission next month as far as what the schedule looks like. Audubon Road. The work there was delayed because of a problem with the culvert fabrication. The culvert has finally arrived. The road is closed. I'm sure it's the.
It is happening.
I'm sure, as you can attest, work is ongoing there. Paving is actually planned for this fall once the culvert is completely installed. And Hinckley Street is closed. It's local access only. This construction is going to continue into next construction season. We're going to take a break this winter, but that's a very significant reconstruction there. And the last item is the sidewalk inventory. So there were thousands of data points that were collected as part of the sidewalk inventory, and now we need to get them into a usable format for us, and that usable format is going to require that we're able to prioritize where repairs and reconstruction needs to happen, or where construction actually needs to happen. So at this time, the data is sort of being manipulated to get that report into a format that is actually going to be available to us. So the consultant is continuing to work on that with the DPW, and there will be more updates.
Thank you very much. Any questions for Director Viscali?
I have a question. I've just been asked several times, and I hate to even bring up speed bumps, but a question of whether or not any speed humps, bumps, or tables are going on Ryan Road. I can't recall because I've lost track. Are there any going in?
At this time, there's no plans for installation.
Thanks.
Any other comments or questions?
I've not heard, but I left that something for my report. Thank you, Command. The Lieutenant Governor just announced this afternoon we've got a $50,000 grant to help extend the rail trail. It's not enough to do everything. We're looking for other grants as well.
Congratulations.
There seems to be a counter on State Street. Is that right? There's a strip on State Street.
Is that due to counter them?
And then for about a week,
we didn't put anything on.
Pioneer Valley Planning Commission.
So maybe someone's just spying on my house on State Street. There's something in front of my house on State Street that's been there for like a week and a half.
Can I
buy
it up?
Okay.
Any other comments or questions, DPW? Any other departments like to provide anything? Okay, thank you very much. So we have a lot of matters before the commission. Let me ask, I know that Councilor Bidwell is here for Prospect Street. Is there anyone else who's here for a specific item that I can move up earlier?
I'm also here for Prospect.
Prospect Street. Okay, Jennifer.
Well, I was here for Federal Street.
Okay. Maybe we'll take that after Prospect Street.
Thank you.
Okay. So let's see. Let's skip to 5I, which is an ordinance. This is 17.3. 379, ordinance relative to parking on Prospect Street. And we have many ordinances. Here we go. So I'll read this just for the record, although there's a map, and we'll also explain it. This would amend section 312-102, schedule 1, parking prohibited at all times. And it would add Prospect Street on the easterly side from Jackson Street to a point 32 feet easterly of Murphy Terrace. And then it would add in section 312-104, to schedule 3, limit time parking, it would add Prospect Street on the easterly side. It would add 15-minute only zone from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. Monday through Saturday, starting at a point 112 feet westerly from Adair Place to a point 130 feet westerly from Adair Place. And I guess I'd start by asking the DPW, our traffic engineer, to put that into English, and then we can get comments.
Sure. So first of all, we're going to put in 3 new painted spaces in front of the newer building across from the YMCA, because there's additional space there. And they didn't do that as part of the paving project in 2015. So those aren't timed spaces. They don't need to go in the ordinance, but I put them on the map for a visual. And so there'd also be no parking from Jackson Street all the way up to those new painted spaces, so that people can't park on the corner of Murphy Terrace. And then we would turn one of the spaces in front of the Meadowlark preschool into a 15-minute space for pickup.
Okay. And this originates with a request from Meadowlark School because they've had trouble with pickup and drop off. Counselor, do you want to comment on this to start?
I would defer to the director of the YMCA, Julie Costello, who has spent a lot of time thinking about this, and I believe has a suggestion that might work even better for Meadowlark and for the Y.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Julie Costello, director of the YMCA. So parking is a challenge. As you know, the Y was built in 1965 and was not necessarily built for the 7,000 members that we now serve, in addition to the participants that come. So parking's always been a challenge. And I did talk to the owner of Meadowlark earlier this year because our members are using our spaces, we asked the staff to park on the street, which then I wasn't even thinking about Meadowlark, caused difficulty for the parents dropping off. So we changed that. So we've had a great relationship since I've been there for the past 18 months, trying to figure out parking. The problem is we have 7,000 members plus staff, plus our staff that all want to park there. The biggest time that is a challenge is at drop-off and pick-up for daycare. So we have parents that are running across the street. We have members that are also trying to cross the street to come to the Y. I'm not confident that one 15-minute space is going to serve her needs. I was suggesting to Dennis maybe the 3 spaces in front of her house become 15-minute drop-offs, or 2 spaces at least, but only for the period of time during pick-up and drop-off. So you have maybe, you know, from 7:30 in the morning till 9:15. I know that would be somewhat confusing, but offer more space for those parents to come and get their kids right in front of our house. And then perhaps limit the time that people can park on the street for 2 to 3 hours. I probably will hear from staff about that, but you know, it's really hard. We have 30 full-time staff and, you know, probably 80 to 100 part-time staff that are trying to find parking spots, plus all of our members. So to honor Meadowlark, my suggestion would be more than one 15-minute spot, but not all day long. There's really no need for them to come and go that quickly all day long.
Thank you. Any questions for Ms. Costello?
Have an even better idea for all the parking here, that'd be awesome.
Well, have you had the chance, sort of like, not your job, maybe it's my job, but have you had the chance to talk to the administrators of Meadowlark about the alternative proposal?
I have not about that particular proposal, just about we tried to encourage people not to park there. We even put it on our sign, our entrance on both staff and public side to say, please honor our neighbors, be respectful and try not to park in front of there during pickup time. You know, I serve the same community you serve, and people want what they want when they want it.
That's true. I can vouch for that. So. Any thoughts on from Commission? Oh,
yes, So the parking that's prohibited on this map that we have, that there used to be parking there, or parking was allowed there?
Parking was allowed.
And around how many spots? That was maybe two of you to park there? But what I'm getting at is, so we have three proposed new spots. Is that like a net gain of three more, or no? Are we just replacing the spots that we're parking now would be prohibited with those spots?
I think I can answer.
Okay.
Sounds to me like you're gaining three spots, but you're losing one parking spot. Sorry, Ryan.
No, it's fine. I think that's right. In front of the house that where the curb was closed.
Okay.
I think it's some kind of mixed use. Right in front of Murphy Terrace, there's no painted lines. So my understanding is we're adding three there, no matter what. But none of those will be 15-minute spaces. And then we're proposing to make some number of the next three down Prospect Street. This would have one 15-minute space at all times of the day, well, between 8 and 6. So the question is, how many of those would be 15-minute spaces, if any?
And can you, even if you just have the one, is it possible to have it during certain times? Because I think having it all day, you are going to, first of all, people are going to violate it, which may or may not be good for you. And if you can have it, you know, more structured for that pickup and delivery, and even have a sign out, I mean, I had suggested to her, she put the sign out, just please, you know, utilize this space for drop off.
Is there any concern about increasing the number of spaces that are 15 minutes or restricting them to a certain time of day?
Is there anywhere else where we restrict where we have 15 minutes for only a certain amount of time? Limited? No.
School zones are reduced for a certain time of day. You could have the same, well, almost the same, maybe the same period of time, 7:30 in the morning to 9:30 or something. I wouldn't have any problem with restricting the time of day if it were useful. I'm just more concerned, you know, is three too many?
Could we have somebody from Metal Arc speak to the commission and get their perspective?
We can't, or we could pass out an amended version, and if they object, we could bring it back up. Probably before the next Legislative Matters meeting, so they can move it along. But I agree, it would be important to run it by, which I will commit to doing, and I'll copy the word to Councilman.
The one thing I would add is, and I would be very pleased if the Commission moved this forward, because besides the fact that there's just these parking issues, which are a result of the tremendous success of the lot, basically, which I'm delighted to see, there's a real public safety issue that gets worse and worse, because now you've got, and I've seen this, Metal Arc parents parking, or kind of double parking, parking on the opposite side, on the Y side of Prospect, and during a very busy time of the day, and in the middle of the street, not paying as much attention as you or I would like, just running across, and something happens at the, you know, in the 4 to 6 grade of time, and anything that could be done to alleviate that by putting these 15-minute drop-off spaces on that side of the street, I think would forego a disaster that's waiting to happen, frankly.
I wonder, too, I think I was going to bring something up about a crosswalk. I know there's not an intersection there, but is there any way to make that a school zone? You've got the synagogue there, you've got the Y, and you've got Meadowlark, and people fly from that intersection to, you know, they come out of the stop sign by Child's Park and they just go really fast. So, you know.
We recently made a school zone around the synagogue school.
Yeah.
and we're restricted by state law about where we can do this. Strangely, we can't ever establish a school zone around the high school, for example, because the law is based on the grade of the students who attend the school. So for whatever reason, preschools are not eligible. Mm. But there's a school zone that ends not far from that location. Mm. And we probably would be shy about a crosswalk because it's mid-block.
Right.
Generally unexpected, yeah. And we wouldn't want to create the perception of safety and not go down.
Because people don't want to walk to this crosswalk to come in and walk on the treadmill.
Okay.
How far is the school zone?
How far is
towards
the school?
Jackson, yeah. Remember?
No, I don't.
I feel like it somewhat encompasses that area. Right?
I think the school zone either just touches Meadowlark or possibly includes it. But we don't have signage or anything that indicates the school zone up yet. That's fine. Okay, well, thank you. Thank you very much. Any other comment from the public on this? Any other discussion to the commission? Any preference about how to proceed? I agree with you, nice to move it forward with some modifications, knowing that if the Meadowlark people have issues, we're going to have to look at it again, because that's only fair. But it'll be good to advance it. Anyone want to make a recommendation? Then I would suggest asking the DPW to come up with the measurements to expand the 15-minute signs to 3 spaces, and also restricting them to, let's just say, the same time period that is in effect for school zones for consistency, which I don't remember the exact time to drop off. That would be my motion on the recommendation.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on those changes?
Going to be enforceable, but are they these patterns? Just another stretch for their parking enforcement.
Well, parking enforcement goes up there anyways because of the bike lane, because of parking problems and complaints that come in on a regular basis for that area. 7:30 in the morning, that would fall to the police department. I mean, it's only 30 minutes, because parking comes on at 8 in the morning. The parking enforcement is up there anyways, so it's just another thing to be watching for. It's not a big deal.
It would be another sign having to state the time. We don't have anything else like that.
No, we don't have anything else like that.
Yeah, 15 minutes parking.
Twice a day.
Certain times of the day.
Right. Twice, morning
and afternoon.
In
the afternoon as
well. I think it would be important to find out when would be the best time. I mean, the pickup time at Meadowlark may be very different than an after-school pickup time. I don't know what their day looks like, so I'm not sure that matching it to all those schools would make sense.
Would it be fair to word the motion that we'll restrict the time to accommodate whatever those hours are? Or is that too sort of vague of a commission? In other words, our decision will be that the 15-minute spaces will be in effect, to say, for a 2-hour period around drop-off and pickup for now.
I think it's fine as long as you want to do the research before it's formally submitted to council.
We need measurements from DPW anyway, for expanding into 3 spaces. Okay.
Right. Sorry. So if this goes through, what is the time frame that you would say this went through and this is when it's going to start? Because I think the more that we can educate our members that this is the right thing to do, mm-hmm. the better this will all go over.
Let's see.
So I just don't want it to start, start on a Monday and we get told on a Friday.
Don't worry, nothing ever happens that fast. I can assure you. I think the fastest, let's see, if the city council referred it to our legislative committee, which has to happen, it would meet the second Monday in October. That's right. And then the city council would have to vote on it twice. You'd be into November.
Yeah.
Slow enough for you?
Yeah.
Good.
Great.
Any other comments?
You said a question. So is the pickup and drop off only for the daycare, or does the Y need I mean, are there programs where people are doing pickup and drop off?
Not at that time. You know, it's more pickup and drop off for us is more somebody's dropping off for gymnastics at 4 o'clock and they wouldn't use those spots. They pull right up to the front. Thank you. We don't have daycare at the Y.
Any other comments for today? We still have a motion to change the recommendation. It's like an amendment. Any other comments on the amendment? All in favor of changing it that way? Say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstain? Okay. I should have done this before, but it doesn't really matter. Is there a motion for a positive recommendation as amended?
Did that be original mark from us?
I think I didn't ask for it.
Oh.
Who did I?
Exactly.
I thought you did.
Who made it?
I seconded it.
Who made and seconded that motion?
You did, and I seconded it.
I think I made a motion to amend. So just to play safe, nothing wrong with a little redundancy in addition to being slow. We can really gum up the works here. Can I just have a motion for a positive recommendation?
Positive recommendation.
Okay, made by Director Fyde, seconded by Councilor Shara. Any other discussion on the amended motion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Thank you very much. So we'll keep
Thank
in
you.
Touch to you guys for it. Thank you. Now we'll go to item I, which is Federal Street. DPW, want to provide an update? Federal Street.
Sure. So, Federal Street. In November of 2015, an application was submitted to the TPC for traffic calming and accepted by the commission. At that time, the residents were concerned with high traffic speeds and pedestrian safety due to the narrow road and the lack of sidewalks. So in September of 2016, traffic counters were installed for 1 week. And I have some data that I will run through and then some comments that I will present for discussion. So the average daily traffic that we recorded was 524 vehicles per day, of which 0.2% of those were trucks. The 85th percentile speed ranged from 30 to 32 miles an hour. The speed limit is posted at 30 miles an hour. So the 85th percentile is kind of a national metric that describes the speed at or below which 85% of drivers travel. So this is like a national standard that's used when establishing speed limits. So the other thing I'll say about the speed limit on Federal Street at 30 miles an hour is that this is a posted speed limit, meaning that MassDOT has accepted an engineering recommendation from a study that was done at some previous date by an outside engineering firm that provided traffic volumes and the data that's acceptable to MassDOT, and then MassDOT actually approved this speed limit to be 30 miles an hour. So our traffic counters are showing that people are traveling between 30 and 32 miles an hour on this roadway. So now just a few comments about this. Federal Street obviously serves pedestrians, bicyclists, and motor vehicle traffic kind of in the same area. The road is narrow. In fact, it's 23 feet wide, and there's parking allowed on one side of it. So when we think about, what does it take to install a sidewalk here, we've got space constraints. Additionally, and I don't want to go too far down this road, but you have to consider the grade too. So if you have, the street and a grade like this on either side of it, in an angle, you can't really get a sidewalk in there. So we have to think about these considerations when determining how do we make this safe for pedestrians. So we think about, what are possible options. You don't have a speeding problem, if you will, with a 30 mile an hour posted speed limit and people going basically 30 miles an hour. So one of the things that we've kind of discussed internally in the DPW, and Councilor O'Donnell and I have discussed this a little bit, is a pedestrian lane. So this is, and there's a picture that is in front of all members of the commission. I don't know if you want to provide a copy of this photo just to have a look at it. But a pedestrian lane is basically a 5 foot wide dedicated lane for pedestrian traffic. It's kind of something very similar to like the bike lanes that you see around town. There's not a physical barrier. It's a painted, you know, barrier. It's more of a psychological barrier, if you will. But designating that this would be a lane for pedestrian travel. This gets a little bit tricky because you have parking allowed on one side of the roadway. So you're going to end up with a situation if you take another, you know, 5 feet off the road and you allow parking, you could potentially have two cars trying to pass, you know, in the same travel lane. The pictures that are in front of everyone are out west, you know, where these have been kind of implemented in areas where there are no sidewalks. So it obviously there's nothing like this in Northampton now, but it is a possibility. So a couple of other things. We are also having a conversation about the feasibility of installing a crosswalk across Federal Street at its intersection with Elm. So we're not going across Elm, we're just going across Federal. And the other factor that's kind of a big deal here is Hinckley Street is closed. It's open to local traffic only at this time, so you're seeing a displacement of traffic that could naturally be traveling down Hinckley Street, landing on Federal Street, the extent to which we don't really know. And you're not really going to know until that project is completed. The project isn't going to be completed likely until this time or possibly even a little bit later next year.
One comment that just when Donna said there's no city pedestrian lanes, there's no city owned ones, but that was a condition for Chloe Dickinson. So there is one of these on Chloe Dickinson's back access from Elm Street up to the hospital. It's narrower, I think, than your time. There's something 2.5 feet. Yeah.
Interesting, thank you. Do you know anything about how it performs? Any problems?
I don't, other than my own experience. People seem to respect the lines.
Okay.
Like when I've seen people drive down there, that's just random.
Yeah, sure. Any public comment on Federal Street? Well, I think this has been before the commission for a long time, and if we were following our traffic calming policy, we wouldn't arrive at the conclusion of putting speed bumps building something like that on the street, because we haven't measured speeding over the posted speed limit. I think that is pretty clear from our policy. The question then, I know in the mind of many residents, is can we drop the speed limit? And as Director Mascali pointed out, it's a state process, and if we wanted to ask the state to do it, we'd have to pay for an additional study of a certain kind, and there's no guarantee the study would recommend that the speed limit go down. Is that characterizing it correctly?
That is correct.
Okay. And the other piece is, someone brought to my attention that there's a state piece of state legislation enacted about a year and a half ago that allows cities and towns to lower the speed limit to 25 miles an hour in residential neighborhoods like this, but only when the road is not posted. And so that also would not apply to Federal Street. So, I think for the purposes of doing something on Federal Street, we are left with, I'm going to call them either creative or expensive ideas. Creative, for example, the striped pedestrian lane, and expensive would be something like reconfiguring the intersection with Elm, which is a bad intersection, and I think should be reconfigured. It's a very wide turning lane. People can come into the street quickly. So I'd be in favor of looking at that. But I think for the purpose of the traffic calming application we have, I'm not sure there's something we could do pursuing that actual application, since the speed is 30 miles an hour on Federal Street. So my preference is to keep this open, if you will, because I think we should continue to look for ideas. We should run this idea by other members of the neighborhood. This is the painted pedestrian lane, for example. The addition of a crosswalk, if feasible. So we should keep it open in that sense, but I'm not sure it makes sense to talk about installing speed bumps on Federal Street. Are there any other comments?
Question. Would the proposed lane be the entire length of Federal, or is there a particular section that you're looking at? It is a long street. I don't know if you're talking about the whole thing.
We're looking at the section right off Elm Street. Okay.
From Elm to, do you know how far down?
Yeah, we go to, what's the next cross street? Is it Riverside?
Riverside.
You go from Elm to Riverside.
Okay.
The other thing we would really have to look at too is parking on that street. And, you know, that's also a double-edged sword, because if you eliminate parking, now you've sort of visually opened the roadway, and that definitely would have the potential to increase speeding. But now you've given yourself more room for the pedestrian lane. So it's sort of a mixed bag as far as the parking goes. The parking doesn't help with visibility, certainly.
By way of contrast, when the DPW measured the speed on Naugatuck Street, it was an average of 5 to 12 miles per hour over the posted speed limit. So a different situation than in Federal Street, where the most you get is 2 miles, 85th percentile. Is there any other discussion from the commission, council?
I would just support the notion of keeping open the study of a reconfiguration of the Elm Street Federal intersection, which is really for cars, for cyclists. I've seen several near tragedies with cyclists there because it's just at the weird angle and the weird sight lines. So I know that's a very large project, but I think it's worth at least keep it open. So
I agree. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's the intersection that's the problem. It's so dangerous.
Well, on that point, when we raised the issue of a crosswalk, how real or in sight would adding a crosswalk be? I know there are other complications. For example, it would be a crosswalk sort of to nowhere, because then the crosswalk would continue, and I think it gets cut off by a driveway after one house or something.
Yes, so there's definitely some right-of-way challenges there. There's right. A sidewalk that sort of stops and starts. You know, when we land in the realm of intersection redesign, you know, it requires engaging an outside consultant, which, you know, obviously starts to turn into a little bit of a process. Director Fiden and I have had conversations about possible temporary measures that could be sort of instituted at this intersection to try to square it off a little bit. You know, kind of dropping some jersey barriers, you know, to just sort of tighten things up a little bit. Chief Casper and I have had a conversation about possibly doing like a trial one way, you know, so you don't have two-way traffic heading into that intersection. But again, any sort of permanent modification to the intersection is going to require the engagement of an outside consultant and you know, all of the permitting and design things that sort of go along with redesigning the roadway. So it's a very long process. So any sort of temporary accommodation we make is just that. It's temporary and not necessarily guaranteed to ultimately be part of the final design.
Do we have a long-term plan? I mean, we all have talked about this intersection many times on this committee. What does it take to at least recognizing that things move so slowly? I mean, where are we with thinking about our, we do need to move forward with a redesign, even if it happens in 7 or 8 years or 10 years. Like, when do we start that process so that it started?
I mean, the process ultimately starts with a discussion, yeah. But this kind of lands in the capital improvement category, and we have to balance the need for, you know, roadway reconstruction over 160 miles of roadway with sort of focusing, you know, huge amount of resources on one particular area. So it would be part of the capital improvements process to, you know, I guess allocate money to, you know, something that the city decided was a major priority over many years. The price tag for this has zero.
Okay. I think Chief raised a really good point, and I'm also wondering, does the sidewalk inventory intersect with this at all? So it can reveal any need. You know, the feature of this area is it's a route to the high school.
The sidewalk inventory will definitely capture this area as, you know, likely in need of construction of a sidewalk, you know, sort of based on proximity to the high school and you know, volume of vehicles and pedestrians, if you will. And again, that goes on to a priority ranking list for us that also includes the sidewalks that are in states of disrepair and the areas that, you know, don't have them. You know, and then that's a priority list for a conversation, you know, among city officials and residents to determine what's priority for us.
Is there any more discussion from the Commission or the public today? I'm not sure we'll solve the issue today, but I do agree it should be kept open so that we can continue to bat around possibilities. No? Then, unless there's any objection, we'll continue this. Thank you. Let's see, so now let's go all the way back up to item A. This is allowing low-speed pedal assisted bicycles on North Hampton's multi-use trails. So I'll turn it over to Director Friedman.
Just passing, ignoring two issues. So, sort of two things came up at the same time. Chief Casper sent me an email pointing out that we don't allow electric vehicles, or we don't allow motorized vehicles on the bike path, and we should figure out what we want to allow. It's old language. This is a language written in 1985. The city adopted the bikeway. Arguably, the bikeway was the term as was used in Northampton. It's just the area from State Street to Bridge Road. So we started to clean that up. And then 2 days later, after that email, we awarded this bid to the Wegan, which is for electric assist bicycle. And so that forces the issue for us a little bit. But, as it stands now, when we do the bicycles, they could be used on city streets, but it couldn't be used on bike paths themselves. So there's two documents in front of you. Let me explain the more confusing one first, the green spreadsheet. What we did is we wanted to figure out how bad is it to be hit by a bicycle, right? You can, you know, a bicycle moving is heavy enough, with a heavy enough rider is moving fast enough, can kill a person if you hit them. And so we wanted to approach this saying, well, at the very least, if we allow electric assist bicycles, we should make sure that they could potentially have less energy than traditional bicycles. So we sort of ran it three ways. So by performance bicycles, I'm taking very thin tired, very lightweight bicycles that people go 20 miles an hour. I don't, but you know, the people in shape who ride seriously. And so we ran the amount of energy people who, you know, I used 150 pound person to 225 pound person on a lightweight bicycle moving top speed of 17 miles an hour. Serious riders who go faster, but really serious riders usually like the bike path. So this seemed to be a realistic scenario for the bike path. Then I did a mid-range bicycle. So think of this as your, you know, hybrid bicycle or a typical bicycle most of us own. Weighs a little bit more, we go a little bit slower, and ran it again for those four scenarios. And then I did the pedelec bicycle, the one that's here. But assuming that we do a garbage, so it's a much heavier bicycle, 75 pounds, which obviously creates more of an oomph when it hits you. But assuming, this is my recommendation, that we do a garbage, we have a speed limit. For private bicycles, privately owned ped assist bicycles, there'd be a speed limit that would apply. For our bicycles, we can do what's called geofencing. So we don't have to rely on the bicyclists to follow our rules. We can say, when you're on the bicycle, when you're on the bike path, this bicycle won't allow you to go faster. You can still go faster in a steep downhill, but based on how fast you go on a flat, we can set that speed. And so 12 miles an hour is what I suggested because it's low enough that it has lower energy impacts than in the other, than in normal scenarios, so people are less likely to be hurt. And it's low enough that you can see further along, so you have better reaction times, so it's actually safer. But it's high enough we're not going to have people complain and say, I can't get anywhere, I don't want to use this bus. So that's sort of where the problem is. So that was sort of background. And then the proposed ordinance, this is for discussion, you know, obviously feel free to make changes. Proposed ordinance, first of all, changes the language, because again, bikeway is a language we use just for this 3 mile bike path. It may or may not apply elsewhere. Switching it to multi-use trails, and adding, and basically saying, we still don't allow motorized vehicles, which is our current rules, as Mass General Law defines them. But there's an exemption carved out under federal law for electric vehicles, or electric-assist bicycles that are below 1 horsepower. It's a really poorly written federal law. You can read all the blogs out there on the federal law exempt state law. It's really exempt state law in the sense that these are consumer vehicles and not motor vehicles. And at least from the Department of Motor Vehicles, they've given one opinion that yes, they're exempt under the state law. But just so you know, New York State is a totally different from New York State, since they're not exempt from the state law. My suggestion is using a federal definition, so below 753 watts, below 1 horsepower, and saying those bicycles, as well as electric mobility for ADA, people with disabilities, that we would allow them on the bike paths, again, up to 12 miles. And then while I was cleaning this up, we've been allowing practically for years people to ride 24 hours a day, not just going to dusk. In fact, when we extended the bike path through Leeds, or through Look Park into Leeds, that was one of the specific things we approached Look Park for. Look Park didn't allow use at night. And we said, hey, we can't run a bike path through here unless you allow use at night, because people can go home at night. And so, right, but I hadn't realized this ordinance was here. So, frankly, for the last 10 years, the only legal place to ride at night is through Look Park, not the rest of our system. So, this would clean up that.
We haven't been heavily enforcing that.
Yeah, I'm sure you have. We did a rolling workshop this weekend, and someone, of course, using this bicycle, and I think, okay, we all have maintenance vehicles. So Jody pulls me over and says, it's a maintenance vehicle. Okay.
Any comments or discussion? What are you looking for today from the commission? Recommendation on?
Yeah, policy? Recommendation. You said the way it was advertised, you don't think you guys could vote on it today. But, so if you.
I'd like to not vote on it. Ordinance, like recommend a specific ordinance.
So what I'd probably ask then is a recommendation, and what we'd do is I'd introduce the ordinance to council, not on your behalf, on behalf of the mayor and planning, and then we'll get referred back to you. So you'd get a second crack as it goes through the process, but we can start. The one thing I want to play with a little bit is, because the software we're getting for the electric bicycles would allow us to set lots of different geofencing, Northampton can set whatever speed limit they want. But that said, for the sake, frankly, of the decals we put on the bicycle, we're trying to work with the other communities who have bike paths to see if we can all agree at the same speed. Just because we, you know, because then I can put a decal on the bicycle that says you can't go higher than 12 miles an hour on a bike path. If Springfield chooses 11 and we choose 12. So, you know, that may not happen because they're slower than we are.
Just one question, Wayne. What's the estimated kickoff date for the
pedelecs? April 1st, but it can only be slowed down. So April 1st with the vendor told us they could make it.
Okay.
But for example, you know, if you want to be scared on the bicycles, Google Baltimore and you see they've had some problems with their bicycles. We actually think it's great because it means Baltimore did the learning curve. They've recalled their bicycles, they're retrofitting them, and they're going to come back in 6 weeks, and we're going to get the model to retrofit them. But things could slow down if we have other problems. But April 1st at the earliest, June 1st at the latest.
How many units?
Region-wide, 500. In Northampton, roughly about 140. Still looking at the exact number.
Would you like to make a motion for such on the floor?
Sure. I'd make a motion. We recommend an ordinance effectively as this. It will still come back to you to sort of start the process.
Is there a second?
Sure. Second.
Is there any discussion on the motion?
I don't want to argue against anything, but just so you know. So when I presented the open space recreation multi-use plan to City Council to kick it off, I mentioned this in passing. Immediately someone called the mayor's office the next day to say, I'm strongly opposed to allowing electric vehicles of any kind on bike path. So I'd love to start the process, but I don't want to mislead you. I'm sure there'll be some opposition will come out once this process goes through.
Got it. Okay. Thank you. Any other discussion? All those in favor of the recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Passes unanimously. Thank you. I'd like to ask our one member of the public if there's any particular issue she's here for. I didn't notice you before. I'm sorry.
I had a meeting in Springfield, so I got here late, but I had two questions, and one was the Federal Street that I knew was coming up. But I came in so late, I didn't want to add anything, but I do want to add something if I can.
Okay.
I'm a representative at Care One. I'm the ombudsman here. And we have a lot of people in wheelchairs. And they go down, they have the freedom. It's a nursing home that they can sign out. They go down the driveway at Care One, go up the section of sidewalk on Elm Street, and then turn that horrendous corner that I drive in and out of about 10 times a week or 12 times a week. And it strikes terror in my heart because of the openness of that corner, but not a visual openness in that corner. So a lot of us don't come out when we work with the elders, and I just think that people have to consider sitting in a wheelchair. In fact, one of the residents said, I need you to sit in my wheelchair and try to go up that hill. I can't do it. I cannot do it. I don't have the body strength. And I'd like that to be a consideration, and I know you just talked on this, but I will come back to another meeting, but I'm sorry, 5 o'clock didn't get into my...
That's okay. And could I ask your name for the
record? My name is Kathy Robinson.
Kathy Robinson.
And I live on Maple Street in Florence.
Okay. Well, we'll enter that into our minutes, and it'll be...
I just have a concern about that. That's,
yeah, I appreciate
and the same thing, because I go there unexpected times, so I'm there when the kids get out of school, I'm there when the kids walk into school, because I also have a concern about that wide intersection, and then they have to cross over. Is that South Main Street, maybe that cuts into that? I think right. That's called South Main Street. And they cut over and they'll walk up, but there's no sidewalks. And we have a lot of young people there, too.
So that's my concern,
and that's why I'm here.
Yeah, no, I'm not sure if you got here when we, I think there's kind of unanimity around the fact that the intersection is very problematic, and we were discussing.
I heard that. I just would like to have another country heard from me because I represent, there are at least three electric wheelchairs.
Well, thank you.
Okay.
I have to move on from the subject, but we'll return to this to Federal Street.
Okay, well, I'll try to come next month, but I had a meeting in Springfield, I couldn't get here before. So thank you very much.
Move to item B, which is open space recreation and multi-use trail plan. That's again directed by.
So I gave a presentation to council, so I'm going to be briefer for you all. So this is sort of a kickoff, just because you've heard this all. So every 7 years, we do this open space recreation, multi-use trail plan. And it is two things for us. One is it really is sort of our master document for where we're buying open space, how we manage open space, where we're buying recreation areas, how we rehab recreation areas, and where we're extending bike paths and trail trails. And one thing is it's a planning document. The other thing is it's a precondition for a lot of the state's grants. And so we were adding it up. We've received over $4.5 million over the last 7 years based on the last plan. So it's really important that the plan, just sort of privately, it makes the plan a little bit weird because we want it to be a real planning document, but we also want to support anything we decide to do 6 years from now. So I try to make sure we even apply for grants. And what we did 7 years ago, which we'd like to do again this time, is even though it's only required by law to be adopted by the planning board, we tend to take it to all the other boards who have say it's a conservation commission, it's a recreation commission, city council doesn't frankly mean much unless they do it. And because the recreation trails part, the bike path part, 7 years ago we had to do all of that would be our and so just very briefly in terms of where we are on the rail trail network, so you know, we have sort of four different projects that we're working on in no particular order. One is looking at where should we do additional access ramps onto the bike network. So our current metrics is we want the bike paths to serve 75% of the population. Because some areas that are rural we're never going to serve. When we do that by taking the bike path and buffering it by, we have to use half a mile, 3/4 mile. Then we come up and figure that right now we're serving 65% of the population. But it's a little misleading because there's sections where the bike path is, for example, going on railroad tracks, where someone might live 100 feet away but can't actually get to it. Or in Leeds, there's literally a mile of bike path where there's no off-ramps. So we're looking at a series of on-ramps and off-ramps, and really making sense. On Saturday, we did a rolling workshop where we sort of invited people from the neighborhoods to come and tell us what are their priorities for on-ramps. Some people don't want on-ramps because they're worried about increasing traffic in their neighborhood. Some people desperately want on-ramps because they want their kids to get their life path safer. So we're looking at a series of those things. The top two on our priority list are getting off. So the North South Trail is the New Haven and New Hampton Trail, and the Mr. West Trail is also. The top two on our list are off-ramp behind ServiceNet by Edward Square, and then off-ramp by the Northern Exit and Moore Park. We apply for funding for those, and get the funding. But we're looking at, sort of up and down. So Blackberry Lane comes within 40 feet of the bike path. There's a well-defined trail that people have been using for 20 years, 30 years. Should we pave that last 50 feet? That's flat, that'd be pretty easy. There are other sections that would be much more of a challenge. Actually, the paved section at Gale Place, but the paved section does not meet the ADA standards. I don't know if we created ADA or if we just ignored them. And we have everything in between. So you can see along the bike path what we call desire lines, places where there's a really strong desire. The Look Park, northern entrance, actually had such strong desire lines as causing major erosion problems. DPW had to fix it. It's a section where the asphalt trail was literally about to break off because people would walk down the hills on the cut and DPW fixed it. It was just before we got here, a year or two ago. But that's the first one, looking at all these desire lines and trying to find a way to fix that. The second one is this related to that $50,000 grant I just mentioned. Is extend the bike path the last third of a mile up to the Williamsburg Kent line. And we're working with Williamsburg, and they're trying to extend it into Williamsburg. Our right of way actually extends into Williamsburg about a third.